Good evening, everyone. Welcome to episode 2 of Belligerence and Benevolence series 3, our continuing chronicle of Tolstoyan and Chekhovian now, and one day, God help us, maybe even Pasternakian, Russian literature inspired Good Society games. I have this phenomenal and very special cast, including Haley and V, the creators of Good Society, who have generously consented to join us in our little cavalcade of in jokes and bizarre references and extremely queer Russians. So speaking of extremely queer Russians, why don't I start by introducing Serafina, who for once is so far playing a straight character, the Countess Valeriya Vitalievna Ivanovna, a very nice and just a delicious young thing.
Yeah, that's right. I'm so gay, I'm straight. It's happening. So yeah, I am playing the Countess Valeriya Vitalievna Ivanova, also known as Lyra. And she is the exemplar. So she has, you know, come from a family of just absolutely exemplary human beings. Her older sister is a picture of perfection. And she fully intends in some ways to maintain that. However, she is desperately infatuated with Pasha, who is just the most lovely, intelligent, and dear human. And her parents and everyone around her sort of expect her to marry Count Roman Stefanovich Morozov, who is lovely, but definitely gay. And she doesn't really fancy him. So we will see how all this goes. It's really gonna end very well for her, I'm sure.
Lovely, but definitely gay. : the history of cats Russian society games. I guess we have no choice but to just immediately jump over to Richard, who's playing the aforementioned Count Roman Stepanovich Morozov.
You're about to say lovely but definitely gay, the Richard Ruane story.
Well, I think you're lovely, but I don't want to speak for our audience. Maybe they have, you know, more rugged views of you. I don't know.
I'm Richard. I am playing Count Roman Stepanovich Morozov, and I'm using the philosopher from a Bohemian background. Roma is until fairly recently a student in Krakow, who has returned to Moscow without degree, but has a lot of opinions, nevertheless, about how things should be going, none of which his older brother, the senior Count Morozov, listens to. In fact, things like, no, you should not break up with your poor fiance just to marry someone wealthy, and all sorts of terrible scandals that Roma finds himself needing to manage, including the scandal of being both gay and Catholic in 19th century Russia.
I mean, one of those is unacceptable. I mean, one would seem to be a mistake. Two would seem to just be a provocation. Speaking of provocation, even though in this time, so far, he's been extremely nice and kind and sweet and lovable. We await Silent Derald's empire. Please welcome Derald, who's playing Prince Pavel Petrovich Trifonov.
Hello, hello. Yes, I am playing our beloved Pasha, who has finally accepted his father's name. So Pasha is the humble dependent of the Trifonov family, born and raised not as a Trifonov, is a formerly illegitimate son who is being welcomed back into the fold with open arms. Not really. He just doesn't know how to Russia. He doesn't know how to society. He doesn't know how to do anything except write the most sweet, sweet poetry to his secret fiance, Lyra, and have delicate conversations with his sister, Zenya. And he's off to war now pretty soon because of like being basically caroused into enlisting by this woman that he met at a party who just really like kept talking and didn't give him a break at all. She said it was good for him. And also she may be also my fiance. There was this whole thing about my father probably paying a huge dowry to marry me off to this other person that is definitely not my secret fiance. I'm just this poor marshmallow who will definitely not cause the ruin of anyone in this room. It's fine.
Poor, pitiful me. It's not always a great look. So, speaking of that whole mess, why don't we go to one corner of this bizarre love polygon? Please, let's welcome the esteemed and wonderful Haley, who is playing Count Nikolai Antonovich Lavrov, a fine person of upstanding reputation. Sure.
Nikolai from the disgraced Lavrov family. A lot of money, very little reputation. Trying to restore his family name, sort of, but also disgracing it continuously at the same time is basically his thing, easily bored. In an unhappy marriage to Alina, who is Lyra's sister. We'll see where that goes.
And from the ridiculous to the sublime, why don't we welcome V, who's playing the very sweet and put upon Princess Evgeniya Petrovna Trifonovna.
Hello. Xenia, she's named, is the eldest of the Trifonova family children and is a fast approaching spinsterhood at this stage, which is great. I think that is where she wants to be, really. But is constantly at the precipice of, you know, do I make this marshmallow boy brother of mine, Pasha, be stronger, or do I try to protect the marshmallow from all ills? And do I rein my father in so that our family does not spend all of their money and become disgraceful, or do I let him have the run of it for now? So I think I'm constantly beset by these small problems of others. And I think that's Xenia, yeah.
Well, we think she's lovely. And I guess that leaves me. Hi, I'm Kat. I'm playing the Princess Aleksandra Fyodorovna Karagna. Who is basically a trash fire of a human being in extremely sultry form. She had a thing, maybe, for Nikolai that didn't come to fruition. She is extremely close friends with Roman and maybe the only person he can talk to without any reservation. And right now she is just deciding which chess piece on this board she's going to push around and make hurt. Because, you know, she needs to make people hurt so that she can feel something, or it's pretty bad. But all that said, introductions are now out of the way. So hey, let's capture the anarchic spirit of the original Belligerence Benevolence, which was, by the way, the first game of Good Society I ever attempted to facilitate after playing it like 3 times. So we have some work to do because we're playing the Emma expansion by the charming and lovely Helian V. And that one handles drama, big plus for us, but also extended passages of time, which, you know, again, plus for us, because we've been doing that, but now we actually have rules, and rules are good. So how is this going to work? So this is the fun part where I get to explain to the creators how their game works, but basically we're going to take 2 rounds of turns, and in our turns, we'll set a scene and a vignette, not at the same time. We just have to do one of each. And the vignettes and scenes can be all kinds of things. The scenes, they're scenes. We've done this before. But there are some small rules about that. So basically what we're going to do is we can have a weather interlude. A weather interlude is a new thing for Emma expansion, where we will use a thematic weather pattern to do a monologue or vignette that will eliminate something of the twisted and horrific inner lives of our characters. We can have a scene or vignette about a rumor coming true, And there are some decent ones out there, including what's called a changing fortune. Now, a changing fortune is also a new thing for Emma, which allows us to decide that certain moments are going to become pivotal in our characters' lives. And if they do, they may expose a fortune that becomes a rumor. I have offered to all my players here, especially the ones who are going off to beat the tar out of Napoleon in Austria, that they may write a changing fortune about their character, because you know what? Pretty much everybody in War and Peace thought it was going to be, so it's good enough for us. You can have a scene or vignette about your character's inner conflict, which aren't on the board yet, so maybe not that one so much, but you know, we can foreshadow them. And we can pay a you can pay a resolve token. I've seen a vignette about anything else. On the side of your character key bill, you will see up at the top, there's a little box that has all the different weather vignettes. Now, the plan I have is we sort of broke off the novel chapter at the end of summer 1805, which we're going to call August. So, you know, in parts of Russia, that's optimistic. The Battle of Austerlitz takes place in the beginning of December. 1805. It's actually a cool battle. I recommend folks at home, those three of you, to look this up because it's actually a fairly dramatic battle. But the long and short of it is Napoleon was outnumbered, confronted by both the Austrian and Russian army, suckered them by retreating off the high ground. Then the day of the battle, there was this huge mist that concealed what was going on. When the Russians and the Austrians attacked Napoleon's right, he waited until the sun peeled off the fog and then sent a bunch of screaming Frenchmen straight up the heights, cut their army in half, and completely destroyed the Russian and Austrian armies as things to worry about for another year. It is generally considered Napoleon's finest battle. It's certainly the big highlight of the early glory years of the emperor. So all said, what I figure we'll do is we'll pick back up sometime after this, sometime in 1806-ish, maybe even as far as 1807, because in July of 1807, after a couple more years of running around, being the tar out of the Prussians and the Russians, Russian and France come to the Peace of Tilsit in 1807, where they become uneasy allies for another 4 or 5 years. So that could also be a thing to do for the return. But in the meantime, we do have to do the passage of time. I don't have an order here. So we all have to do one scene and one vignette. If anyone wants to start, that is cool. Did I get everything I have to do, H and V?
Well, I can go first if no one wants to.
Please bail us out.
Okay, cool. I'm going to do a weather vignette. And it is late at night on the battlefield, and the sky is murky and dark with clouds and smoke wafting through the air. And in a foxhole somewhere is Powell, and he is holding his rifle, and you can just hear him whispering 17, 18, 19. And it sounds like he's almost counting the seconds between the lightning and the thunder. And then suddenly there's a motion, and he jumps up and fires into the night, and a scream can be heard on the far side of the battlefield. And he ducks back down, and he starts counting over again. 1, 2, 3, 4.
I dare someone to follow that.
I have a vignette also. We see Lyra sort of a small montage of her getting up in the morning, running downstairs in her nightgown and house coat, and meeting a servant at the door who has the mail on a tray, tearing through all of it, and then sort of resolutely walking back up the stairs. And we see that happen a couple of times, her getting less and less enthusiastic about the prospect of checking the mail. And then we see her mother like tapping on her door and getting no answer. And then her, you know, going back down the stairs and her mother tapping on the door and getting no answer. And she's just laying in bed as like time passes and days pass.
Haley, did Kolya stay?
So I think that what Kolya did was, instead of enlisting, decide to profiteer off the war, which I'm sure won't be a problem for his, starting his family's reputation. So, I mean, I can jump in there with his, because I think his vignette is day, the simple joys or the busyness of life. And like, I think what he does is like invest his money in artillery, bullets, other things that are going to need a lot of buying. So I think his day vignette is like him touring a factory. He, like, the person is showing him how the bullets are being constructed. He's picking them up and looking at them. He doesn't know anything about bullets, so he's nodding, yes, this is a good bullet. And like, you know, shaking hands and like, and then going to like a restaurant near where he is and like eating a big lunch and sort of like thinking about what the eventual fate of the bullets is going to be.
Then I think that my vignette will be like an overcast one. And I think it's sort of like, yeah, it's maybe like in town or something where I see, I don't know if Kolya notices, but Evgeniya is just somewhere and like sees him about his business in this regular business of life kind of thing. And I think that we see that her eyes sort of like narrow and she watches him for a moment. And I think the only thing we hear of her monologue at this point is she's just watching him, silence. And then she says, she's thinking to herself, I've never seen you be so like such a coward. And she like turns on her heel and I think she's, yeah. And then goes about her own day as well. But I think the afterthought for her is, I guess I'm a coward too.
I would like to have a scene with Pasha, since we are both near the front. Is that okay, Daryl?
Yes.
And I think this is several days before your vignette. And we are still sort of in a boisterous village of camp followers. And have you grown a hussar mustache? The classic mustache that hussars are famous for? Or are you?
There was an attempt. It didn't go well. So he is clean shaven.
So I think, and why are you in the village? Are you like drinking with the soldiers, walking through?
I think that, yeah, I'm probably socializing. Okay. Like, you know, hanging out with the rowdy guys and just having a good time.
So I think I'm standing next to you when I hand you like a small glass, like just a cheap makeshift, like a demi cup of some sort of brandy. And I'm standing there and I look absurd because not only do I have my weird protruding ears that I've always had, I have a giant mustache. And I give you a small salute along with the brandy. And I said, like, will you drink with me, Pasha?
And I probably, like, if it's okay with you, like, take a look back at the other guys who are, like, maybe, like, giving you some dirty looks. But
I'm not from your unit.
Does your reputation precede you?
Now, I think I think I like, you know, I'm a lieutenant, and so my whole existence is about being unpopular so the captain can be respected.
Yes. Okay. And I kind of just like, you know, like mousily like slide into the bar and like grab the glass of brandy and says, of course, Roma. And it's like still testing out like the familiar name.
How are things in your particular captain's unit?
Oh, things are going really well. Since we're setting this before my little thing, I'd say that we actually haven't been in battle yet. So I have no idea what's waiting for me. I say, yeah, things are going really well. They say that I am doing really well with my marksmanship. They're calling me a little bit of a sharpshooter. So yeah.
And how's your writing?
I admit my letters have
not been... Writing.
Oh, writing. Yes. Definitely better than my letter writing.
Speaking of that, yes. Do you have something you would like me to send along?
And like, he like, the hand goes to his breast pocket because there's a like half-lit written letter to Lara in there. And there's probably like a brief flashback of like, you know, scribbling a line, crossing it out. And he taps it for like a second or two and says, not today, Roma. I'm still working on something.
I can wait to send this. You know that we do expect to engage the French in the next 3 days, if not sooner.
Oh, well then I'll definitely need to put something in the post before then, won't I?
If you would like, I can fold it into mine so that there will be no maternal interference.
Yes, of course. And like now it's like clicking into place. Like, oh yeah, you are supposed to be my fiance's fiance, which is a thing that I've completely forgotten about. And he says, yes, wonderful idea. You know, can I perhaps visit you later this evening with my finished letter?
Of course. While you're there, I would like to make sure you get a key to my footlocker. The standard procedure would be to return my locker to my brother, should I not return. And there is a small courier satchel of particular letters in there that could be useful to your cause, should I not be able to return to Petersburg or Moscow with our companions, if you understand me.
Roman Stepanovich, you have nothing to worry about. Our troops are going to completely annihilate the French. There's no concern at all.
Nevertheless, battle does not mean that every person on the winning side will walk away.
He reaches across the table and like pats you on the forearm and says, if it will make you feel more at ease, then yes, I promise to deliver your things safely to the people who need them and to make sure that the things that don't need to go to the certain people don't end up there.
I merely hope that should they return to my brother, they will simply be burned and will not be useful to Lyra or yourself.
Pasha just kind of like, is like, looks kind of confused, but like, is like, of course. And then just takes like a big swig of the brandy and then probably immediately spits it out because he's not used to like such an alcohol.
Cheers then, Pasha. It has been good to see you. Stop by tonight and let me give me what you would have me deliver. I down my brandy and return to scowling at the people I'm supposed to scowl at, who are my captain's troops, so that, you know, lieutenant's unpopular, so captain can be popular.
I probably like sip my what's left of my thimble full of brandy and then like set it down on the table and salute and walk away. So a big smile on my face. I'm full of confidence right now. Everything's going to be fine.
So I guess that leaves me, huh? Cool. So I'm going to do a weather vignette because, you know, why not jump on this and never done one? I'm going to go with overcast. So this is a late afternoon in St. Petersburg. And to quote Wallace Stevens, it's one of those days where it's evening all afternoon. It's snowing and it is going to snow. And we zoom in on Sasha in the back of a sledge with Evgeniya and Lara, and they're next to each other, and Lara's probably chattering away, and Evgeniya is probably, you know, looking like, why am I here? Yes, making those little noncommittal, yes, yes, Lara, it was very excellent D kind of things. They're on their rounds of visiting. They have a party to go to tonight. But Sasha's just sort of looking out of the sled and like in voiceover you hear, dear Roman, one of the challenges of writing a serial letter is that your mood changes from time to time. You'll receive from me some enormous sheaf of notes and different opinions and changing information. I suppose that will create some sort of basic tension in the whole narrative, as if I was some shabby magazine writer. I have heard nothing from you since the reports of our action at Schöngraben. Everyone here in Petersburg is in great praise of the sovereign and general, the commander in chief, and of course, brave Prince Pyotr Bagration, not noticing that what really happened is that they saved the army through the skint of a hard day's fighting against two entire corps of the French. I fear some great disaster is coming, and your silence only confirms that to me for now. I don't know what it is that makes me miss you so. I mean, beyond the obvious that you are the one person I can confide all to and that you confide all to me and all that. But it's more than that. I miss a charming conversational companion. I have Lyra and Evgeniya on her good days. And Nikolai is in town and we can always cross sabers that way. I think, dearest Romilia, it's because you're the one person in this whole rotting Russian state of ours that I'd look on with no thought of instrumentality. You are never a piece on my chessboards. You're at worst the knowing tutor who smiles when I make a particularly clever move or tries to pat me on the shoulder when I make an error. And I suppose under your tutelage, I make less of those now. I won't say things like life would be not worth living without you, but it would be shockingly diminished. Please, let me remind you of you dodged the promise, but please do not die. That is my ongoing wish for you as we approach Christmas, and that would be an appropriate present to give me in this coming month of darkness. Please come back to me. I'm sure tomorrow I will have something better to say, but until then, Sasha. So that's all of us. Most of us have scenes.
I have like an idea for a scene, but it has, I'll need to use my positive reputation tag sensible, and I think I'll have to offer it to Pasha. One of the rumors that I saw was Pavel's claim to the Trifonov name are baseless. And I wonder, I'm offering my result token, if that is in fact true. You might not know that, but I guess it sort of affects your, I think Richard, you're playing Pasha's mom. I don't know if we're interested in going there as a table, but that'd be
yes, I am
interesting.
I am Pasha's mom.
Yeah, that like this is some elaborate plan of Pasha's mom to sort of successfully dupe everyone. And it's like my feeling is like Xenia's like the reputation tech is sensible. Like she's followed up really closely in all of these like things. And I think the scene would be me confronting or like our conversation. But it does affect obviously Pasha most. So I wanna hear what Daryl's input there is.
I really like it. I just wanna like, if anything comes out of it, I want the idea to be like, maybe, like I wanna stay in the family at least for one more episode. If I end up leaving the family, getting kicked out or something like that, it can't be just from this conversation.
Yeah, okay, cool. I like that. I think that's a good thing. It just complicates you coming back, but I think it's also bad for Xenia if this comes out. Yeah, okay, cool. We'll keep you in the fold for now. Yeah, at least for one more episode. I'm good with that. Okay, so that's, so I'm going to cross out that reputation tag and that rumor and scandal, which is about you being. And I think to set the scene, I mean, what, Richard, where would I find Lara or Larissa?
I think perhaps she had been doing some sort of like profitable trade work, maybe like sewing or running a shop of some sort, so that she had a certain amount of money, but not not an established landed income of any sort. And ever since she sort of like was able to get Pasha into the Trifonov household. She's the Trifonov household. She's been living a little bit more like a poor member of the gentry, since she is the mother of a future noble, or the mother of an aristocrat.
Yeah, and I wonder. So I think, you know, I think this is like a house call then, that Xenia is, it's late in the afternoon. She's had some business around town. She doesn't necessarily want people to like know. So she's slipping away in this like dusky glow, not the same overcast day. There is some sort of light permeating somewhere, but it's kind of like a dull flat light. And I think she knocks.
And I think, yes, the my one servant, the maid, will announce and let you in.
And Evgeniya is looking around, just quietly taking things in until such time as you appear.
Princess.
May we have a conversation?
Of course, but first you have to tell me whether I kiss your hand first or you kiss mine.
I think that Evgeniya raises her hand just in the way that like, okay, we need to get these things done and dusted because I am going to cut to the chase in just a moment.
She
moves her hand up.
She gives a very dramatic curtsy and kisses your hand. It is charming to see you.
I see that.
Princess, please be seated.
Of course.
Forgive the small drawing room. This is such a tiny apartment.
Not at all. And she flops down quite quickly. I have made some inquiries with a certain inquiries into the lineage of my brother, Pavel Petrovich.
I'm very interested to hear about these inquiries.
Of course, I will let you know directly. I'll let you know, but I wanted to give you an opportunity to speak to it.
Speak to what?
Speak to... speak to it. And she just like looks at you like, here's your chance, mate.
I do not care what Prince Trifonov's former valet said.
The man is a notorious liar. And yet so convincing in other ways.
What do you mean?
I mean, it's awfully convenient that Pavel grew up. You've had this knowledge under your and now is the time that it's awfully convenient, I must say.
You know how these things are. One cannot simply reveal such things that could be a.
Jenny just like sighs. There's like tea or some sort of drink there. She will take a sip. Look, I'm not trying to. I don't want to undo this. I just have to know. I just have to know. I just have to know the truth.
Truth is a very, very difficult topic, Madame Princess. It is certainly hard for a woman in my position to know all of the truth. Your father understands human biology quite well and would certainly know if it were impossible for Pasha to be my child or his child. But I will tell you, Madam Princess, if I can be very certain of your confidentiality.
Of course, she says.
If I can be very certain of your confidentiality, Princess, I will tell you that Prince Trifonov's former valet and I did have certain relationships at a time that would be inconvenient were those relationships to become known and would certainly undo the confidence that I have built in your father, that he is the only possible person to have been Pavel's father. The so-called Roman is entirely a fiction, of course, but I am sure you understand how.
I see. And Pavel has no inkling on this matter. Has no knowledge.
If Pavel were your son, would you have told him?
Not in a million years. I see.
It is. Quite awkward.
And yet my heart is it. Oh, sorry, go ahead.
It is quite awkward. And then she's just staring into space. Refusing to meet your eyes.
I think that Evgeniya says, I've always been one burdened by questions, and there is always some form of relief, release when a question meets its end. But in this case, I'm not certain there is somewhere for that ending to rest comfortably. So the question is open as far as I'm concerned, but I will keep to my word, and nothing that was said in this room will be repeated by me.
I appreciate it, Princess. I think you will certainly understand that no one stands to gain by opening questions that your father, the prince, sees as resolved.
Indeed. I must say, I think she does the like, I've got an engagement after this with the Princess Karagina and the Countess Ivanova, and so I think for today we must leave this here, probably never to return to it, but I must go.
Then
thank you for your frankness.
Be friends and not return to unpleasant topics.
I think friends is a stretch, and she stands up. but I think that that's when we cut to, you know, the scene of her in the carriage being totally out of it and looking out the window.
Serafina, are you up for putting on your Boris mustache?
Is there ever a time when I don't want to put on my Boris mustache? I got you, boo.
All right. So yeah, my scene's probably going to be, I want to set it like after that one. And also just to kind of telegraph where I'm going, I'm probably going to take a positive reputation tag. And I was thinking of making Boris like my person who like believes I can do no wrong. So if we want to lay the track for that, especially for my potential engagement to your sister.
Yeah. Anyway.
Cool.
All right, where are we meeting? Is this after the war or is it during? Am I still your CO? What's going on?
Oh, I think you are still my CO. I think that it's been a long and grueling battle and we both made it out on the other side. And like the difference between like that brash and like innocent kid that went in and then this gaunt skeleton that came out is very, very surprising. Well, maybe not surprising for you, but definitely surprising for Pasha.
Yeah, I think Boris has had someone bring you to his tent. Like somebody went and got you. And when you walk in, it's sort of, you know, like it's an officer's tent, but we're on the front lines. It's not like that posh, all things considered, but he does have, you know, like a letter writing desk. His, you know, cot is like fairly well appointed. He's got a bunch of pillows and stuff, but it's still like raggedy. And when you come in, when you step up to the tent, he like sees your shadow from the firelight beyond you and calls you in, and he's stretched out on his bunk with a bottle in one hand. And he says, sit down for God's sake, you make me tired.
He sits immediately down on like a small like camp seat that's been erected near the bed, like hands like vice gripped into his trousers at the knee. And he won't look at you, but he's looking at that bottle.
Pasha, if I give you this bottle, do you promise to, if you become an alcoholic, at least be an entertaining one?
Yes, sir.
Don't call me sir. And he hands you the bottle.
He takes like the longest swig from it. Like he's determined to get as much in a single gulp as possible.
My God, man. You really were undone on the battlefield today, weren't you?
He like just sets the bottle on his knee and says, 47.
Kills?
Yes.
And before today?
You see him doing like math in his head. And there's a point where he's like, that number gets bigger and bigger, and I do not want to know where it ends.
Do you know the secret to making it out of war?
He looks expectantly at you.
Well, the way I see it, a man has several choices. He can either find his way down to the bottom of a bottle and die at the end of a bayonet, his prerogative. He can lose himself in slightly inauspicious company as a way to find some comfort on the front lines. I leave it up to you whether that be camp follower or fellow soldier. I don't know your proclivities. Or he can consign himself to God and the possibility of the life he will live when he returns home. He can separate who he has been here from the man he will be when he sets foot in his home city.
Pasha appears to ponder this for a moment and looks you in the eye and says, "The man who will go back to his city is not the man who walked on this battlefield."
Well, of course not. How could he be? He has seen things that the boy who walked onto this field had never seen before. Every day we wake up a different person. My dear boy, if you were the same as you were the day you got here, I would worry for your sanity.
Pasha like takes another swig of the bottle and says, and turns to you and says, "And is it worth it to bury all these men that I put bullets in every day and bury them next to the boy that I was when I walked here?"
Well, are you asking your commanding officer or are you asking Boris?
I know exactly what my commanding officer would say. So what does Boris say?
Well, I'm curious about the former. But the latter will tell you that it's never worth it. War. I can buck you up with stories about Mother Russia and I can tell you about the glory of battle, but you've already seen it. War is hell. Nothing's ever solved out here. It just gets pushed off to the next battle. It gets pushed off to the next regime. It gets pushed off into the next country. It goes on forever. It's pointless. But here's the other secret, which is that life is pointless. We make our meaning where we find it. So what are you learning here? Today you killed 46 men?
47.
You survived those 47 men. What does that tell you about who you are?
Captain, are you sure you are not the inappropriate company I should not be keeping?
I never said I was appropriate.
Pasha takes like another huge swig and is very obviously already starting to get drunk.
If you get me court-martialed, you'll never get the good booze again. And he takes the bottle out of your hand and takes a swig of it.
Yeah, I feel like that's probably a good place to wrap that.
I really like Boris.
I knew you would, brother of mine.
I have no idea what I want to do for a scene, by the way.
I have got a vignette idea, unless Fina, if you want to go first or...
No, I just was like, if people have thoughts, help me. Go ahead, Richard.
I'm trying to figure out what my weather is. I think it is a rainy, rainy day as things are being packed and people are pulling away, continuing to pull away across out of the Austrian Empire into closer to what is currently Russia. I am dropping off letters with a courier writer, someone who is going to go ahead to Petersburg ahead of us. And a package No, not a packet. And then going off and brushing my horse, the water out of my horse's mane, even though it's largely useless because it's that sort of heavy December winter mist that's just all around you, and there's no shielding anyone from it. And I'm letting most of the unit or most of the units pass me as I use sheer glare power to stop several people in our unit from goofing off, and remind them of the task that we have in guarding pulling back to Russia from Austerlitz. And then we hear the letter, "My dearest princess, your serenity, you know that I treasure your friendship with all of my heart. But if you ever refer to me as charming again, I shall not forgive you. First, a small matter of business. You will remember a certain Prince Trifonov. I have given him a small package to deliver to you. Some of these are letters and keepsakes that you have looked over for me before, since, as you know, I have no true privacy in my brother's Moscow nor Petersburg house. I do hope to be joining you in Petersburg soon. You will also notice in that package another package of keepsakes and letters. These are not from me, but from my brother to someone that we will not discuss. I trust that you will look over these with the same discretion you have always helped to guard my secrets. I have often told other people that I do not tell lies, but I do keep secrets. And you are the one person who I do not believe I have ever been tempted to lie to or to hold secrets from. Your brother continues to be infuriating. But I have discovered that, I am better able to deal with him when I do not glare at him with disapproval every chance I get. I have instead turned that to ensuring discipline in the ranks. I do promise you that war is as awful as I've always thought, and that humans are as prone to holding on to their lives as, I've always suspected. Prone to holding on to their lives at the expense of those they can order to stand guard between themselves and death. I will not call out any particular people who were here at Austerlitz for fear that this letter see us both hanged. But it did not speak, nothing that has transpired here has spoken well of the nature of humanity. Forgive me for not writing sooner. I have much to say to you that can only be said honestly in person. Please know you are perpetually in my thoughts. Your very good friend, Roma.
So, Nikolai, would you care to be at a ball?
Love to.
So I think this is sometime in January-ish. It's now late enough after the news of the disaster that we're allowed to have balls, but His Imperial Majesty has not yet returned to Russia, so things are a little more low-key. I think we're waltzing.
I love that. For Nikolai, like, his clothing has upscaled a bit. He's gone from rich to ridiculously rich. And he is very, he lacks taste. So he definitely has no problem reflecting that on in the cut of his clothing.
My cher Nicola.
It's a different outfit every time you see him.
My cher Nicola, they say at the heart of every great fortune lies a crime. You must be truly one of the master criminals of all of Europe. I fear to leave my purse anywhere near you.
Nonsense. They needed something and I simply provided it. It was give and take.
You do have that habit of doing things, don't you?
What else is one to do? What others are ordered one to do? I think not.
So I hope you respect the Christian charity I have been doing in taking care of the Princess Valerie and your own dear... Well, now, what is it with you and Evgeniya? I see her whenever I mention your name, my dear Nicola. She is more upset about that than almost anything, save the time Yatveyevna burned the toast that one morning. That really threw her off. Though come to think of it, I believe she was writing you right at that time.
You know how to remind me of my past endeavors. Be assured, I have no intention of closing that book at its current point. I have been thinking of inviting her for lunch.
For lunch? I see. An investment lunch? Or is this one of your other endeavors?
One can never tell. Often things start one way and end the other.
I note that you have not invited me to lunch, and I could use both. I could use investment.
If you should like to have lunch, I shall prepare three lunches for you, but you shall not be joining me in Evgeniya.
What on earth is it between the two of you? One would think you would be oil and water, the basse bleu and the... Well, now, what are you now? Cock of the Walk, Beau Brummel?
I am... It is perplexing to me as well. I am quite... practice in receiving disappointed looks from all of those around me, but Evgeniya has such a look of disappointment. It is almost a thing of beauty how well she has perfected it.
Yes, I feel almost stung. I mean, I've disapproved of you for years.
Oh, but your disapproval only makes me feel joyous, for it means that I have done something worthy of your attentions.
Yes, and that's what attracts me to this whole situation with you and our dear Evgeniya. I think, if I were a foolish, prattling gossip of a woman, I would say that she harbors some deep emotional connection to you, but that would be foolish of me, wouldn't it?
I certainly think it would.
Or would it
or
merely...
perhaps it would be foolish of her.
Perhaps. Perhaps that the only foolish thing would be for me to say that aloud.
The soldiers will be returning soon. That is sure to change the nature of St. Petersburg, don't you think?
Do you think that your dear darling Evgeniya is going to be distracted by a few epaulets and a couple of ribbons bestowed by His Imperial Majesty?
I think she is more likely to be distracted by the return of her project.
Oh, yes, little Pasha. I hear so many strange things about what he's done on the front. They say he's become quite the Mars.
I wrote to investigate. After all, I did take your words last time seriously, but it seems he was well and truly taking care of himself. I'm very impressed I did not see it in him.
Well, good on little Pasha. It's good to find one's métier at such a young age.
Certainly.
In all honesty, oh, what of me?
Yes.
I await the return of our brave soldier boys, for which I shall happily crown them with the laurels of victory. Well, victory and defeat, and hopefully matrimony. In all honesty, Nikolai, you've been avoiding me, and I find that intolerable. I've already lost my best friend to this hideous war. You don't even have the excuse of that.
Well, the only consolation you have is that it seems I am very bad at avoiding you, for look at where we are now.
Oh, but this is just a waltz. Any idiot can waltz, and those that are too silly to waltz know how to mazurka.
If you were looking for me, then concoct something worthy of my attention.
I would love to, but it's so difficult with Evgeniya insisting that we have petit salon and Lara digging her nose into all the latest of the reports and then sighing hideously as she considers what fate befalls her fiancé, of course.
Of course.
We are just a pair of haggard old crows, aren't we, Nicholas?
I like to think of myself as a young crow. Haggard, perhaps less as the days go by.
Indeed. It is well that we're taking a brief respite from war, for you would grow too rich and own all of Russia.
Well, everyone has to aspire to something.
Yes, I suppose what this is all you have left to aspire to. Oh, look, the music stopped. Please do come call upon us on Thursdays. That's our usual day.
I will.
So I think you have to do a scene. And
I need to do a scene.
Haley, well. Yeah.
Yep. I don't know. I'm just full of despair. Who wants to be despairing with me? Who wants to take the piss out of me for being despairing?
Me? You know I always got you, babe, but...
I mean, I know.
Alternately, there is your older sister.
There is my older sister who is perfect.
Oh, God, yes.
Oh, God. Okay, somebody should pee her. Yeah, I mean, this is going to be interesting. Cool. So I am full of dismay, stretched out on a fainting couch in the library, obviously. And it appears that I was like reading 85 books approximately and gave up somewhere. They're just sort of everywhere. There's a few at my feet. I've got one laying on my chest as I stare out the window.
At that point, I just swoop in and just like come up short and say, here you are again, moping again. Mother is just beside herself for the fact that you won't do anything.
Oh, Lena. What were you saying? Sorry, I was miles away.
Yes, thank you so much for joining us, Lara. I really appreciate that you're taking some time from your busy schedule of staring despondently out the window about your fiance to talk with your dear sister who has come to visit you.
I do appreciate you coming by. What's the matter?
What is the matter is that my dear husband and I have had approximately 3 balls so far, and you have not attended one of them.
Oh, I don't have the heart for dancing.
No one has the heart for dancing, dear. We're in a war, but you have to show up.
Do I?
Yes.
I was reading. She starts going through the books at her feet. I was reading this book on Russian law, and I don't remember ball attendance being mandatory. And I swear I underlined that page.
His Eminence may not have made it explicit, but it is very clearly understood.
Is there a book on the understandings that I missed?
You're supposed to just understand it. Because
but I don't understand
it. Lara, she comes over and like pushes your feet off of the side of the couch and settles, like flounces down and says, "Darling, I'm worried about you."
"Oh, me too."
"All you do every day is just check for letters and stare out the window. You need to come out. You need to have lunch with me and we'll get a glass of champagne in you. That should perk you right up."
Her eyes sort of drift to the window.
She literally like takes you by the chin and turns you back to look at her and says, "You will not get out of it this time."
"But I don't want to go to lunch. I just see all of these people and they're living their lives as if the war wasn't happening. They're putting smiles on their faces. And I was reading this excellent," and she starts like looking through the books again.
She puts a hand on the book and like closes it.
"I was reading these letters from these men from the front, a war that wasn't even ours, a war that was 100 years ago. And my God, sister, it just seems like the worst sort of thing. And I wonder, there have been so many of them and they never seem to stop. Isn't the point of war to propagate peace or something? And how does that even work? They are diametrically opposed concepts. You can't fight your way to peace, no more than you can eat yourself to starvation."
"My dear, I couldn't care in the slightest what you're talking about. We're going to lunch. And this is the reason why we are going to lunch. Because when your fiance returns, Roman Stepanovich cannot find a haggard old crone or he will call it off."
"Well, that wouldn't be the worst thing now, would it? I don't even particularly love him. Now, listen, I'm telling you—
Who loves their husband, my dear? You need to have one in order to advance."
"Do I? I've been questioning a lot of things lately and I just don't think that I've read that anywhere, that one must—
"Yes, you are full of questions, my dear, but you must realize that not every question has an answer. Unless that answer is to go to a ball."
"But why do all the questions have to have the answers you say they have? Because, you see, I've had quite a lot of wine this morning, and the thing that I've realized is that everyone is always telling me exactly how things ought to be. Like you say, I need a husband, or to have lunch, or to go outside, or to stop reading books. But I find myself infinitely consoled by the voices of the ages. They tell me the truth. And the truth is, my darling sister, that I don't believe that marriage is necessarily the best way to go. I mean, all of you seem quite miserable."
"I have just received this most beautiful diamond necklace from my husband. Does this look like the necklace of a miserable woman to you?"
And she, like, in a moment of like absolutely grounded clarity, she like reaches out and she puts her hand on your face and she says,
"Well, the necklace doesn't look miserable, but your eyes. I swear it's as though you've looked into the soul of the devil. That husband of yours, he does seem rather flash. Are you happy, my love?"
She like has that exact reaction. She just like puffs up and puffs up and puffs up as if she's about to say something and then stops her foot and stands up and storms out.
"Do let me know if you want to come back. I'll just be here reading." "It's good. It's going well. She's fine."
That was so good. V. Can I interest you in a lunch between Evgeniya and Nikolai?
Speaking of the devil, sure.
Nikolai has outdone himself on this occasion, even for him. Like, it is freezing cold outside. They're inside somewhere where they have it's like a private room in this place just for them. So much food keeps arriving. It is clearly not humanly possible for them to eat that much food. And like Nikolai is not attempting to eat all the food. He's attempting to find the thing that Evgeniya wants to eat. "Have you tried this?"
She eats exactly half of everything. You know, like, she never quite finishes, like, a bite of everything instead of tucking in.
"I confess it's become a favorite of mine." Although you should see that it looks like it when I order it.
It's very wasteful given what's happening at the front.
We're happy to be wasteful when there is so much of it that keeps appearing. The front is taking care of itself now one way or another, and people are attacked.
It's true. Well, Pasha should be returning soon. I've got the missives.
Indeed, and you shall be so proud of him, no doubt. He shall be duly decorated, and you shall have a brother whom you can parade around society without any doubt.
There's like a uncomfortable but fleeting look on Evgeniya's face. And where is your wife? Is she not joining us?
Oh no, she's very busy. So much to attend to, so many things to organize. It seems like one could pay people to do things for you, the more she seems to have to do herself. I'm not quite sure why. I know you don't approve of me. It's quite obvious. Why ever not? I'm a man who's made my own decisions, and I don't see why you in particular should judge me for them in quite the way you do.
Nikolai, the having of the power and the having of the self-determination does not make one worthy of approval just by the having. It is obviously in the direction that that power takes. What do you do with your money? What do you do with your power?
Is it that I did not go to war? For I supported the war effort in my own way, you know. You cannot shoot the French without bullets. So I have been doing a great contribution. You should see that.
It's hard for me to believe that that was to support the troops when the profits of such gestures towards the table where a new dish is already being pulled in and someone has to actually take out something that still has stuff on the plate to make room on the table. Seems self-serving.
I hate to say it to you, but are we not all seeking to serve ourselves? Even those who marched off to the battlefront did not do it with the intention to deliberately suffer for no gain on their own part. No, they wanted for themselves glory or promotion or the eye of the sovereign or something, something, something. Everyone does something for their own selfish moments and for their own selfish motives. And the fact that they have been unfortunate enough to choose something they must suffer for does not mean that they are more deserving of praise than those who make a better choice. That is my viewpoint.
Jenia huffs, and we don't often see her get into these heated moments, but she says, So, I mean, what do you think? Some of us do not live for our own ends. What do you think? How have you think that I've been self-serving if everyone is?
Do you not enjoy it? I've only gathered that you must, for else why would you do it when you really do not have to?
That's always the thing. You always think that you don't have to do it, that someone else has to pick it up for you. Someone else has to organize that ball for you. Goodness knows Alina is got her hands full doing for on your behalf.
Your father can take care of himself. And what is Pavel to you, really? He is simply a man who appeared out of nowhere and now he is a brother. Surely you do not have an obligation towards him that is so consuming that it would take up your own thoughts and ambitions. What are your thoughts and ambitions, or do you think only of others?
He has a Trifonov name, so I do feel that obligation falls on me as the eldest to guide the boy, I guess the man, now that he's returned from war. Collier, in all honesty, I've never been sure of what it is I want. I thought I knew in the short time we had, but I don't know. Wanting for your own requires a strength and courage that I fear I lack.
I think like Nikolai actually like sits back when he hears this and like takes a moment. Oh, there's a pause in the conversation. And he actually looks at Xenia and he says, "It is a tragedy to live for a reason you do not know. I know that there is a yearning in you somewhere for something. I have felt it myself, and I do think that if you let it go, you'll find your life over without quite knowing why you have led it."
It's rather though that when you want on someone's behalf, you can defend it. You, like the soldiers, can defend Mother Russia. But if you want for yourself and you act towards that, what if you were wrong? What if you were misguided? There is no one else to blame but yourself.
I have been misguided and I have blamed myself, and then I have simply wanted for something more and tried again. It may seem foolish, but how else can I seek? Can I seek to amuse myself? If your brother and your father are the things preventing you, then I will help. I have much at hand with which I can. If your brother should want a position of some kind, I could organize something. I know many people. If your father should need someone to help to fund his lavish events, then I am a very generous man. I shall take these things off your shoulders a little, and then you can tell me what it is that you want.
I think Evgeniya sort of pauses eating and then like pulls a chair back and stands up. And, you know, I think they have enough of an understanding that, you know, it's time kind of thing. And Evgeniya kind of draws closer for a moment and puts a hand on your shoulder and says, "I'm surrounded by people who want well and courageously. I don't think those things are things that I want, Kolya. But I am not ready yet to truly want what I want. But thank you." And then like her hand slides off your shoulder.
"You will have lunch with me again. If you didn't like this, there are many other things I can arrange."
"This is rather too much food for me. Order half for the next time."
"Well, that is a true testament to your character. I begin to arrange to order less already." You can leave them there.
Oh my God. So I think that's everybody, yes? So, hey, we're in upkeep. So we got a bunch of things we gotta do. We finished passage of time. Project achievement unlocked. So one thing we gotta do is come up with inner conflicts. I took the occasion to write mine, which is going to be, believe it or not, true compassion versus vindictiveness. I know I'm starting out way behind on this, but you know, we'll see. I mean, you know, might as well have a real inner conflict here. Second, Haley and V can correct me if I'm wrong. I think a couple of us might need to kick resolve tokens in because we didn't have scenes that were theoretically technically allowed under the passage of time, but I'm not 100% on that. And then third, we have a lot of, we do have some unspent monologue tokens, don't we? So that's got to get done.
Yeah, I'm going with, I don't know, I guess like tradition or maybe family values versus true love. I feel like I'm actually going to call it tradition versus being true. Love. Wow.
Yeah, uh-huh.
A nice parallel with mine, which is a true son of Russia versus a man of my own.
Oh, very nice.
Oh,
Seraphine is over there playing the well, Leo Tolstoy's The Well of Loneliness.
Really sorry.
Look, frequently it's Leo Tolstoy's Brideshead Revisited, so you know.
Always. And you know, Seraphina and I are the only two that have our images in color. I can't but help but feel like that's mean something. I'm not sure what it, but.
I think mine is like truth versus, I don't know what the other side is. It's like the truth versus everyone's being fine by them, you know, like that.
Maybe it's all good. Your truth versus everyone else's.
the truths I know versus truths that are currently there. Yeah.
It's Richard, like the comfortable lie.
Yeah, comfortable lie. Yes, it's truths versus comfortable lies. Yeah.
Anyway, we have some monologues, but also I want to, you know, spend 30 seconds here to make me a man.
I think he should be French.
Oh, should he, though?
Shouldn't he?
Shouldn't he be Russian?
He could be Russian. Okay, here's my thought.
He's technically still at war with France. It doesn't matter. We're all going to be speaking French anyway.
Maybe. I just think he should be a gallant foreigner. Like outside of, like in the fantasy realm of like people who haven't been in the war.
If you're serious about foreigner, then there's only one obvious answer, which is French emigre.
Okay, but then could we make him be an artist? Like something that is outside of, like, he hasn't been to the front is more what I'm thinking.
Okay, yeah, maybe. So we got artists. That's our opening bid. Does anyone else have a characteristic they want?
If other people have other ideas, guy? I don't have really got skin in this game because
I don't have a character, but I am going to change my immediate desire.
Fair enough.
Which is going to be changed to have the courage to say how she really feels about Kolya to Kolya.
Oh, that's a good one. All right. Anybody else have any ideas for the most eligible bachelor in all of Russia?
I feel like he needs to be something that's like just completely contradictory. Like, how would you feel about if he was like a priest or something? It would be such a like a.
I did like say conflict. Eligible, eligible.
I mean, Jesuit.
Jesuits are still celibate, despite the rumors.
Tell that to the Jesuits.
Guys, I'm trying not to be an old maid here, okay?
Rival profiteer of Kolya.
Or
that could work.
What if he is like a businessman? Like somebody that does a lot of like shipping? Because then he could be sort of like a challenge.
See, now to some of the other people here. I want to pick up Serafina's idea that he was an artist, but then let's build this up. He was an artist, a great artist, a notorious pacifist, but when the emperor, the one who has been elected by God to rule over all of Russia, said that we must destroy the gangster Bonaparte, he dropped his art, took up arms, became an aide-de-camp to the commander-in-chief, the good the good, if somewhat out of order, Mikhail Ilyanovich Kutuzov distinguished himself with enormous bravery on the field of Austerlitz, and quite possibly is home in Russia working on a committee where he will explode the vile way that certain people have profited upon the war, sending our officers shoddy equipment, our brave and noble Russian and Orthodox armed forces. Also, he's a poet and speaks seven languages. Let's go with that. Sure.
Sure. Why not?
Wears glasses. He's not afraid to wear spectacles. He doesn't think it makes him unmanly.
Well, I can't play him. I'm your other connection.
Yeah, I'm aware. So, I mean, if anybody.
I mean, it would be fun for me to, as a dude, rampantly seduce each side of the aisle.
I feel like I can't play him because I will probably be talking a lot to him.
I will gladly play him. I'm not going to make him gay. He's a connection. I'm a GM. I run straight NPCs all the time.
But do you?
Great.
As far as anyone knows, yes.
This is sounding like so straight, it loops back around to gay to me.
See, that's what I'm saying. I went so gay that now I'm straight. Richard did the opposite.
If I have to elect somebody, it would be Daryl. But that's just me.
I can totally do it. It'll be an interesting like back and forth between my pure marshmallow boy, my burnt marshmallow boy at this point, and this valiant warrior of justice.
I love that little burnt marshmallow.
So does anybody want to be the darling little Philip Vladislavovich, who is actually Count Andrei Petrovich's clerical aide, and also my war buddy, who I maybe sought comfort with in the trenches, who knows? I can't play a straight character. I tried.
You tried so hard.
You could be bisexual. Yeah, do it.
That'll be nice because that'll give me like a different hook to your character.
Yes. I don't know what he thinks of me just yet. Oh, you know what? You know what? I'm gonna let you decide what you think of me. Like there's obviously like a term, a sense of endearment, but I think you don't see me as like an innocent angel because you also saw me as a murder machine. So
yeah.
And it'll be totally different from the way my sister sees me.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah. Here's my question. Are you coping well or not with the adjustment?
Oh, definitely not. Okay. Like it's one of those things where it's like in public, I probably hold it together, but in private, oh no. It's definitely going to be a plot point where I do not reveal any of this to Lara because I need to hold it together for her, but I can be honest and open with Filia.
Okay, then maybe I think Filia thinks that Pavel is more true to Pavel on the fields than anywhere else I've seen him.
Yikes.
Mm.
Oh, he's a murdering man.
All right. We've got Colonel... we've got Count Andrei Petrovich Kalganov. We do need to do monologues. We of all our monologuing, only Nikolai has monologued and only Evgeniya has spent her token. So the rest of us got to get going. Oh God, you're so young, Valeriya.
I know.
You're just a little thing. Oh, petite Valerie.
Yes, Dad.
I meant to tell everybody what their names would be in French because Russians of this period would do that. But Nikolai would be Nicolas. Pavel would be Paul. Aleksandra is Aleksandra. It's pretty easy. Evgeniya is Eugenie. The future Empress Napoleon, but later. Roman, I think, would just be Roman. And Valeria would be Valerie.
Cute.
I know. All right.
By the way, I just created a connection in case anyone's interested. Marina Yashvina, who is my supportive older cousin, who may have been called in for my nervous breakdown.
I would love to play Marina.
Oh, awesome. You are more than welcome.
Richard, should I play Miroslav, or are we already doing too much together?
Wait. I don't see why not. Someone's got to play Miroslav.
I don't know what you think of me necessarily. I do want Marina to be supportive and like want me to be in the right place. I just don't know what to write there. So you can make stuff up if you want, Haley. I would like to spend a monologue token. Because I am curious what Roman is thinking about the situation with Pavel, like while they're still at war, while he's seeing what's happening with Pavel.
And I think it's when Roman is handing Pavel the courier pouch as they are on the road returning from Austerlitz. Roman watches you, or watches Pasha ride off along the road. Roman is watching Pasha ride off into the sunset, or wait, no, the sunrise, where the sunrise was, headed east, and continues long after Pasha and everyone who's riding with Pasha has like faded over the next hill into the horizon, and there's just this unending line of Russian troops following you because your cavalry and everybody else's infantry, so you're way ahead of big chunks of them. It just begins with 3 years. 3 years older, or sorry, 3 years younger than myself. 3 years, only 3 years. And yet, he calls himself Romanovich, or called himself Romanovich. My father used to tell me that all my hopes rest in you, my sons. And I'm watching him right off, thinking all of my hope, my hope for Lyra's happiness, my hope for my own happiness, they rest in you. I can only pray that you are riding east to bring yourself joy, to find someone you love deeply and dearly, and that you will let me know, Pavel Romanovich, if there is something I can do to find a way to make you happy. And I think that'll be it.
Evgeniya Petrovna.
Yes.
Oh, I would love to hear your thoughts as you walk back from your lunch with Nikolai.
I think it is always summer when I think of him appearing. Somehow, it seems like the sun holds his him in high esteem. I think back on the first time that I saw Kolya silhouetted against the sky, the sun streaming in as though following him. It's a far cry from the winter we find ourselves in, and I think you see her like snuggle in deeper into her clothes, her coat, and like the snow falling around. I must have found it in myself at that age to want, even for a brief moment, for myself, and yet that has become harder and harder over the years. Perhaps that is what being an adult, what becoming a woman is about. Or perhaps not, and I've got it all wrong this entire time. And perhaps at the next lunch, there'll be some of that summer left. And I think that's it. She walks in like into the snow with like the glow of the, I don't know, the eating house restaurant behind her.
I have a question for Valeriya.
Yes.
What, now that everyone is coming back from the front, what is she going to do if Roman renews his sentiments and actually proposes properly?
I think we see Lyra in a church. And it's hard to tell what time of day it is, both by how she's dressed and how she looks in general. It's one of those times of day for sure where there's like only like four or five people, and she's got her head on the pew in front of her and is kneeling. And whispering to herself. And she's saying, I honestly don't know if I truly love Pasha or if it's just what's expected of me. And I wonder if when I see either of them again, Roma or Pasha, if I will see the men that were here before the war, will they be different? Will they be the same? Will they try to be the same? And what's the point of marriage if it isn't for love and companionship? And what is the point of me if I'm not lover and a companion to a man? I suppose I have to get married. And if I think the rules shouldn't necessarily be what they are for me, they are what they are. At least if I married Roman, I would be comfortable. Pasha is a prince. Things that would be expected of us in society, I don't know. And she like rests her chin on the pew in front of her and stares up at the altar and says, you never had these sort of problems. Why am I asking for your advice? Maybe you did and they just never wrote it down. That'd be scandalous, wouldn't it? I don't know. Help me figure this out. If you're even really there listening, it does seem sort of odd. You have other things to do, like the sunrise or something. What time is it? Amen. And she like dragged herself up from the pew and makes her way out of the church.
Pasha, what are you thinking with this packet of stuff that includes, if you were to look into it, Roma doesn't write love letters or love poetry. Roma writes love treatises. So it's a chapter length, you know, love letter to another man, a Polish man, in which he discusses his Catholicism. And in the other part of the packet are the other Count Morozov's love letters and promises of devotion to a former fiance who was secret and who no one knows about, and who is not his very public current fiance. So, or are you not looking at them at all? What are you thinking as this person you barely know, who seems to like be excessively friendly and hopeful every time he talks to you, hands you this packet and says it needs to get to the Princess Karagina, and trust you like he's handing you a secret treaty from the emperor himself. So.
Yeah, so this is at the cot. Wait, you said you handed this parcel over as we were on our way back, or have I had it since we went to war?
No, I gave you the key to retrieve it from my footlocker should I die. But on your way back, since my company is staying behind a bit, of, you know, a week or two, a month or so, whatever, to carry to the Princess Karagina, because my privacy is not, I'm on the road now heavily, and my privacy is not my own to guarantee.
So this takes place at a small campsite, like a day's distance from the city. And I'm reading, I'm sitting, you know, on my rollout bed on the ground, a candle next to me. And I fold down the last page of the last letter, which I have just, you know, it has been my ritual to read them as I go to bed, because privacy, what? Yeah, it's fine. And I stare off like at the canvas top of my tent, and probably my tent mate, who is probably Philip, is like sighing next to me. And I say, I think, how is it possible for a single man to pour so many words out for another person? How can one mind, soul, heart contain such multitudes? Numbers, I understand. 1 + 1 = 2 + 2 = 4 + 4 = 8, on and on and on, building and building and building. But words, they don't seem to mean anything anymore to me. I can't pour them out, like, certainly not like he can, and certainly not the kinds of words that he pours out. I understand now why he wanted someone to take these to his confidant. I don't understand why it was me, but I understand why it was important. How can one person write so much about such happy things and yet seem always so sad? I wonder if he wishes he was as happy as these missives make it sound. I wonder if he craves the kind of love that he professes on these pages. I wonder if he lived in a world where he could have it, if he would truly enjoy it. Is he always haunted because of war? Is he always haunted because of law? Is he always haunted because he is just haunted? He strikes me as someone who's probably just haunted. And yet by so many ghosts that it's hard to name them all. And yet he tries. I'm gonna pull back out one of the other letters, like a particularly like devotional speech that you've made to this former fiance. And I say, once upon a time, I thought that I wrote beautiful love letters. I will never receive a love letter as beautiful as this. There are so many words. 7, 8, 9, 10. And he tucks the envelope away and counts himself to sleep.
Lay it on me, my friend.
I kind of liked where Richard was going, but like what I really want to know actually is the return of society and all of its practices and all of its like rituals and all of its restrictions. You'll have so many more playthings. You'll have so many more partners to your games, but the rules are going to become so much more strict again. How does that make you feel?
So, it's very late at night, and the Princess Aleksandra is finally returning to her apartments and comes in and sees that Liara and Evgeniya are like collapsed in the sitting room. They've just fallen asleep in their clothes, and the servants don't dare come in to wake them. She's looking at them thinking, the papers are calling Austerlitz a great triumph, a magnificent scheme of movement and deception. And you, my poor children, are my own Francis and Alexander. And the war is moving to a new plane, and you are going to be eaten alive when those rules change and the more relaxed attitudes of our wartime suffering are relinquished. If you think there's been competition now with all the boys away, wait until they come back carrying honors and feathers and crosses and lengthy citations in German. And then she just crumples into an armchair and flicks open her fan. But what am I doing? Lara cries herself to sleep every night. Pretends that she doesn't. Evgeniya, I think, would cry herself to sleep if she ever would allow herself to feel something honest in the open. If she could shout into her pillow, I think she would. She probably does. The servants here are excellent and never would fail to give a discretion. Never fail in their discretion. I could protect you, but you're the competition, aren't you? I mean, aren't you? I wish Romilia was back. He would tell me something, probably in Latin, probably some stupid biblical verse. But it would make sense. It would feel like the right thing for all the wrong reasons, because no idea of making him a plaster saint. And yet he knows the way to make me more my best self. Or maybe I'll just toss them all at Nikolai. That'll be worth some sport. Okay. So weirdly enough, epistolary comes after upkeep. It's not weird at all, though. it makes sense because we've got to catch up now because it's been like 6 months, almost a year, maybe even. Let's take a brief second. Probably Epistolary is going to chew up the rest of the session. So we will. You remember how there was that year without a summer? Well, we're going to have the session without a novel chapter. So we should think about where that's going to go. I will know more when we do the next session about what our pace is going to look like, but we should definitely discuss either here or offline whether or not we want to do a fifth session. I'm not honestly sure. Part of me is like, hey, we could probably do it with Passage of Time in the fourth session. But then part of me is like, I don't know. So let's all think about where this is going to go. And we'll know more next week. But in the meantime, I invite people to write their heart out into little letters. Or, you know, write short piquant notes where you'd completely destroy people. They're all acceptable here. We make no judgments. I mean, we make judgments. But you know, they're the nice kind.
I have one from Major Boris Fyodorovich Karagin to my darling sister. I have no idea what hour of the night it is. It's impossible to tell the passage of time when one spends one's time elbow deep in, well, I won't tell you what. It would offend your delicate sensibilities, if you had any. My dear sister, I cannot tell you how much I miss the city and your face and the frivolity that comes from being on the other side of all this. I feel as though I've aged 20 years. I worry for each of the men following me, none the least of which is poor Pavel. I do think we'll return, though, for the man is a positive assassin. Do not tell him I said this. I have a feeling he would cry buckets if he ever sheds a tear again. My sister, I do hope you are keeping in good health. Do look after, well, everyone. I know you will, even if you are looking at them from behind your fan and whispering scornfully to whoever you're whispering scornfully to nowadays. I joke about Pavel crying, but really it's more me. I know it's probably terribly weak-hearted of me to say something like that to you. I should pretend to be of manly stock and bucking up admirably, you know, that sort of thing. But the truth is, well, I think if I stopped crying, I would know I had become a monster. At any rate, I have every intention of seeing you again, if only because I refuse to let the place I die be quite so muddy and disgusting. I love you very dearly. Yours, Boris.
I have a letter from Evgeniya to Valeriya. Dear Lyra, I must say it has been wonderful to get to know you and spend time together. You are so young and yet so full of promise and talent. And I am every day awed by the many things it is that you are able to do. However, of late, I know things have been difficult. And should you have need of an ear, I am more than happy to oblige. But I write to you to invite you to our estate as the youngest of my siblings shall be soon returning, and I would very much like you to be there. Thinking, Pasha probably would in her mind. And so if you could come by such time, that would please me greatly. Also, I must please send my regards to your sister. I know that I've kept her husband away on business and investment matters of late. So please send my great regards. I hope she is doing well. Perhaps you could write to me to let me know how she is going. In any case, I will see you soon. Yours, Evgeniya.
To my most beloved son, Pavel Petrovich, from Prince Pyotr Andreyevich Trifonov. My dearest Pasha, in some ways I count you fortunate, for my day, such wars as existed were dominated by Catherine's chosen, and while I had many fortunes in my life, that was not to be one of them. So, I understand that you have created for yourself a most prestigious career as so far, and I have on good authority that you will be promoted at least one grade as soon as the army has entered its winter quarters, or upon your return to Petersburg, where we all dearly await you. The party season here has been substantially reduced by the departure of all you young men on the mission of His Imperial Majesties. I joke, son. I am well known as a raconteur, a man of quick wit and sterling entertainments, a table renowned as from here to the Iberian Peninsula. Oh, these are true. But I've lacked until now a son. And so to have one that I can be so justifiably proud of, who has won his laurels in the most devastating and difficult circumstances, is enough to make any patriot man proud. That I should have found you in my fond old age and redeem the mistakes of a libertine youth in middle age in such an astonishing fashion is, well, were I more of a praying man, I would dedicate a chapel to one of our saints. Pasha, I know that you've heard the rumors that we are attempting to make you a match. You may have even heard that we have spoken to the Kerrigan family, offering them the capital that they so often require. There is some truth to this. And as a matter of fact, as I am forced to act as your proxy in these affairs, I spoke to the young princess, and she related to me the most curious of stories. She told me that she had great admiration for you and that she felt some small pride in having encouraged you in this military career that has won you such great acclaim. But she strongly hinted that you already had given your affections to someone that was not her. It does not take much for a man of my connections, and let us just call it savoir-faire, to have deduced this matter. So I will tell you this, son. If it is your plan to try and wed the Countess Valeriya Vitalievna, then my advice to you is to take leave as soon as you are able to get permission from your commanding officer. I understand that is the princess's brother and that he may well be willing to grant you this favor. Return to Petersburg with your laurels still upon your chest, and the mud of the battlefield still on your boots. And we shall together pursue this suit. I know that the Countess Galina Konstantinovna is a most difficult target. However, whatever you have learned in the craft of military engineering and siegecraft, I shall apply in my own way to the siege of her heart. This is your best chance for happiness, my son, and I would see you have it. As for the Kerrigans, well, They will undoubtedly need money at some point, so perhaps something else can be arranged with them. Do write me more. I have not been as good a father to you as you deserve. And you've been a far better son to me than I should ever hope to merit. Return as fast as you can to your loving father's arms, and we will pursue this matter together. Yours, etc., His Excellency Prince Piotr, Count, Prince Piotr Andreevich Trifonov.
To the Count Morozov, Konstantin Stepanovich. Sir, I regret that I have not had more time to correspond while I was away. Please know that you have often been in my thoughts. As to the matter we spoke of before I left, that you requested assurances of, please understand that the lady in question has returned to me all of the letters and favors that you had sent her. Per your suggestion, or rather in compliance with your request. I have entrusted these objects to a confidant whose discretion I fully trust. And they should not disturb you. And they should not disturb you further. Yours, Roman Stepanovich.
Nikolai is going to write to Lyra. My dear Lyra, thank you for attending our last ball, although only briefly. It was still good to see you and your family there. If you do not mind me saying so, I think you looked a little out of sorts. Perhaps your thoughts are with somebody who will soon be returning. We all await the close of that chapter, and I hope it brings you peace of mind. But I write to you not about that, but of a question of my own. Namely, advice I can only seek from somebody who knows your sister as well as you know, undoubtedly do. I do not know what to do with her. I had thought that she would do something of her own accord, now that she has everything that she could possibly desire. The house in Moscow, we got that. There's parties she wanted to do her own way, I did let her do that. And all of the things that she asked from the dressmaker and the jeweler, and they've all been procured. And so at this point, I would expect that she would be happy and content to live her own life in accordance with her own wishes. And yet, it does not appear to be the way things have proceeded. I do not know what I can do to assure and support her in leading her own, in spending her own days in the manner of her choosing, without feeling a need to deliberate with me or correspond with me on everything that she may be thinking or deciding to do. We are two people. We both have our own ways and opinions, and there is no need for us to be so interconnected and always doing things similarly or together, really. I hope you might know some way to help her out of her shell and to achieve what it is that she would like to do to spend her time. your brother, Nikolai.
Oh, I've got a letter. from Lyra to Nikolai. My dearest brother, I've been doing a lot of reading. I apologize. I jumped too quickly to the point. I did appreciate being invited to your soiree. It was lovely to go outside. It had been many weeks since I had seen the sun directly, as it were, and not through a window. And I did notice that it's spring, which is lovely. Yes, so that was delightful. But to your point about my sister, I've been doing a lot of reading. And one of the things that I have discovered in my time at it, as it were, is that happiness in marriage is not a guarantee. And I find this to be a great disappointment because I was always assured that it was the absolute highest and loftiest goal to happily ever after it away with whomever one had chosen for one by one's family or society or cruel fate. And so I feel as though I want to give you advice, but my sister is perfect. That's the thing. She's always had everything she's ever wanted. And part of me has often wondered if she doesn't need to be disappointed a little. Perhaps you can give her that disappointment. I don't know. You do seem a strapping chap, though. So perhaps I'm asking too much of you to be disappointing. At any rate, I do understand why it's difficult to get through to her. And I do understand that she is the sort that does very much want to be in one's life at all moments, at every moment, all the time, forever and ever. And I recently had a very upsetting conversation with her where she basically asserted that I needed to go to lunch. And I don't understand why I should have to go to lunch with someone if I don't particularly want to. I was just doing some night reading, you see. And you know what else I've discovered is that not only is happiness in marriage not guaranteed, but happiness in general. And this is also, to me, a great disappointment. I know that I'm only 17. And I know that I am also Russian. And so I suppose that happiness is never a guarantee. But here's the thing that I postulate to you. It is that perhaps you should look less for happiness in your marriage and more for happiness for yourself and hope that the person who is meant to love you till death do us part, et cetera, sickness, health, will then rise to happiness of her own accord as a sort of reaction to you living life to its fullness. I don't know if that's necessarily true. I am not married and I'm only 17, but I do think that one could pursue one's own desires and sort of go about it that way. Again, I am unmarried. My advice may not be any good, but then we go for marriage advice to priests, don't we, before we get married, and they're not married to anyone except God, and I imagine that God is not a really responsive spouse. At any rate, I do love you very dearly, as you are my brother. Feel free to drop by for tea anytime. I've been doing a lot of reading, you see, and I need someone to talk about it with. Yours, et cetera, et cetera, Lyra. P.S. Have you read any of these monstrous war epics written by the Greeks? They do seem to put everything in quite a bright light, and I think that that is also quite disingenuous of them. Yes, yours again. Apologies, Lyra.
Hi. Yeah, I want to follow that up. Cool. So, to Lara, to the Countess Valeriya Vitalievna Ivanova from Prince Pavel Petrovich Trifonov. My dearest Lara, in one short week, I shall clap eyes on your face, and the sun shall rise on the darkest night of my soul. We shall finally, once again, be allowed to be in each other's presence. And I shall finally be able to return to the man I was when I left this city. For 2 months now, I have been reading, and reading is scratched out. I have been thinking in love letter. I have been suffused in love letter. I have been obliterated by words that are so beautiful that I cannot believe they could possibly end up on a page. I have attempted to find some way to raise these words to print, to ink, to put them in this, in a word, in a missive to you, and I have failed. And for that, I am sorry. These last 3 years have been so hard. It has been unlike anything that I could possibly imagine or describe. I don't want to describe it to you because I am afraid that it will unsettle you so in the way that it has unsettled me. I want to believe that it is all a nightmare. I want to believe that when I return and see you again, it will be as if I have finally woken up to a new day. I want to let you know that my father has given me his blessing to pursue your hand in marriage. And I hope that one day we can build a strong, sturdy house with four walls and fill it with all of the memories that we had talked about. I want you to know that I plan to make you the most happy wife who could ever have lived. I want to let you know that I am devastatingly devoted to all of the promises that we made each other all that time ago. And we shall have great balls, and we shall have five children, and we shall live the most decadent, beautiful matrimonial life that one could ever possibly wish for. When I see you, I plan to kiss you 6 times before anyone else can say a word. With all of my love and all of my heart and all my promises and all of my hopes and dreams and wishes, yours, Pasha.
I love him so much.
I think what I will do is write a letter that's also kind of like never meant to be sent. It's like part journal letter. So like Evgeniya has a diary of sorts that has like all of her thoughts. And one of, it's like not in the diary. It's like a separate piece of paper that is written to Pavel, to Pasha, but is meant to like stay in the diary. But if it falls out at any one point and its contents, then who knows? But the letter is a way for her to exercise that knowledge and truth. So it's like, dear Pasha, shortly you'll be returning. Father will be lighting the torch for your bid with the Countess Valeriya, and every happiness will befall you, I am sure of it. And I will be there also to welcome you home and to lie to you about your place in this family. And this letter I write as a disclaimer of sorts, a way to wash away these moments, because these comfortable lies will keep the truth from you. And for that I am glad, for that I am sorry. You are not one of ours, even though now I have given you our name, I would not wish it to be taken away from you. And I will treat you as my brother, but I need some witness of the truth, and so this letter serves as that witness. Yeah, I don't think it needs anything else. I think it's signed from Evgeniya, and we see her sort of like reread the letter, because this is quite, it's been there for months now. She folds it back up in 3 and slips it into her journal, and then tucks that journal into her writing desk in her room.
Okay, I have a letter. to the Princess Aleksandra Fyodorovna Karagina from Count Andrei Petrovich Kalganov. Princess, to say that it was a happy accident when I stumbled upon you at the ball the other evening would be disingenuous. It should be noted that I had been waiting for such a moment my entire life, and it finally came to pass. You brought about the most exquisite conversation that I have ever had the pleasure to be on the receiving end of. The sheer breadth and depth of the subjects that you can cover with such ease astounds even my most loquacious sensibilities, and I find you to be an absolute marvel. Please forgive the excessively florid language that I have just heaped upon you. I promise that it will happen again and again and again. I hope that you will do me the honor of attending a performance next Saturday night at a little theater that I know. You may have heard of it, the Kovalyov Theater. I hear there is a young playwright's performance that is being debuted that night, and I would love to hear your completely unfiltered opinion on it every step of the way. Please say you'll come. Yours, Andrusha. Or your, and then like the that is crossed out, and it's a Count Andrei Petrovich Kalganov.
That immediately gives me my letter, which is from Nikolai to Sasha. I have been thinking, of course, about what kind of favor you might do me to finally make up for your misdeeds and restore our friendship to what it really ought to be. And now it has quite simply occurred to me exactly what it should be. I know that Count Andrei Petrovich Kalganov has written to you. These things become fast known among our circles. And I do hope that the connection between you should proceed smoothly and in accordance with your wishes, of course. And if you were to exert some sort of influence over this gentleman, you might keep him away from me and my business totally and utterly. I cannot outline like the degree to which I would like not to be, like, he's trying to not talk badly of a war hero in a letter, but he's really struggling. In the shining light of his glorious brilliance, which I assure will shine through much of St. Petersburg society, and I only hope that it might not blind me in my affairs. If you could assist me with this, I would be very, very grateful, Nikolai.
It's so strange for me to be the last letter. Dearest Romilia, mon cher, while I know of your religious affectations, this hermitage that you're currently making me suffer through is unseemly. Why are you not here when I need you? I do not wish to speak ill of the horrors I know you must have suffered. My brother has been most explicit in what war is like for men. But I need my support, and you are not here, and I feel as if I had had a leg amputated. Have you met Count Andrei Petrovich? Simply put, my dear, he would be absolutely to your type, were his tastes not less Epicurean than yours. Sadly, when it comes to caviar, he prefers Kaluga exclusively. Or at least so I've heard. I am a gossip, but not a master of gossip, perhaps. I met him, was it just 3 weeks ago, at a ball. And then again at a salon. Some dreadful thing that the Princess Katerina Mikhailovna Yashina was running, which are normally not so boring, but Mulya, he talked to me. He talked to me like you talked to me, except, you know, with the potential for sexual desire. You'll forgive me if I'm harping on this point. I am unstrung. He came by on our visiting day and spent more than an hour, which probably would have given my aunt a heart attack. He played cards with my father. He helped my little cousin learn her steps. He is charming, and I found myself all in a nervous sweat, worrying about what it is I was going to say. What I was going to say. Me, Roman, me. That's underlined like 5 times. How is this happening? I've met handsome men before. I mean, not for nothing, but I was definitely in the field of honor when it came to becoming our sovereign's latest mistress. He is kind and gentle, and he is quiet around me and asks me deep questions. And for only the second time in my life, I thought I had found someone for whom I do not have feelings of instrumentality other than admiration. I do not wish to possess him. I wish that I might be his. This is most disconcerting, and yet I do not feel disconcerted. I feel dizzy. I'd always thought I would make an exceptional match, and now I am staring at one of the most exceptional, and I find that it is not for the reasons I thought I would be happy about this. I figured that I would be a put upon society wife with her own interests, and that I would amuse myself in much the fashion I'm sure you had planned to amuse yourself. And we do need to talk about what I've done with dear Countess Valerie. I should have warned you, but well, we'll discuss that when you decide to stop living on your ark or whatever it is you're doing out there in the countryside, reading your Bible. It's so bad, Romilia, that I am burning incense at the icons every night in the hope that you will wise up and return to me so that we may talk. But in the midst of this, in all this pure feeling that I'm sure would give your little priest friend the absolute palpitations to hear that your goodness had converted the most notorious blackguard in all of Russian female society, in the midst of this moment of transcendent bliss, when finally I am shaken to the roots of my maidenhood. It's not underlined or in italics, but into this comes a letter from Nikolai, reminding me once again that we are all just pieces upon the chessboard of this great game. And as usual, as is his wont, as is his supreme ability, he has taken that which should be good and golden and tarnished it. Roman, I'm at my wit's end. If you do not return to me, I will be forced to talk to my brother. We all know what happens when that starts. By the way, he sends his most kindest regards. Tells me that you're a good sort. Shall I ask him if he knows where your moles are? I ask merely because we share everything. Well, not everything, but in this case, shall we call it an intimate acquaintance? See, this is what I have become. I am reduced to sniping at you like the worst hunter from a blind in a swamp. If you do not return to me this instant, if you do not put this letter down in the middle of this sentence and order your carriage, I have nothing to threaten you with. I shall certainly talk to you again, and you shall always be welcome in my home. And I am miserable. And please come and bring those macaroons that your aunt makes. And come and talk to me, and let us spend all night speaking of things. We have not done so since you came back. I know the war has changed you, but not this much. You're not Pasha. Return to me, Roman, or at the very least, write. Yours desperately, your most beloved sister, Sasha.
Well, I was debating who was going to get my final letter, but now it's obvious. Her Serenity, the Princess Aleksandra Fyodorovna Karagina. Dearest Sasha, I apologize for my delay, but I have taken it upon myself to give news to the families of those that my unit lost. I am returning back to Petersburg soon, and if you do not manage to find time to greet me at the gates, you will never get to see this horrendous mustache that tradition demands I continue to wear as long as I wear the uniform, which will be removed shortly after I return to somewhere I can sit long enough to resign my commission. And then uniform and mustache will come off together, whether you have laughed at them or not. I know that the current state of your heart is giving you some distress and trouble, but please understand, for those of us who love you dearly, it is a source of potential joy and delight. I fear, having briefly known happiness, I discovered that it was not as jubilant as I once had expected, but rather kept one awake at night, pacing the floor, trying to decide how best to respond, occasionally feverish, and frequently incoherently exultant. But you know all this. What you may not know is that apparently men do not like it when you begin love letters with the words argument the first. Imagine the surprise of a young student in Krakow to discover that. My dear friend, I cannot fathom how many young people the war has consumed, all in the name of determining which feckless aristocrat will dominate our empire. I guess I should be cheerful that we have the same emperor as we did at the day we left. And that there are still people left in Russia, and that apparently Napoleon will not invade us again. I am headed to Petersburg soon, and you know how I detest the Morozov estate for anything other than a place to sleep. I do hope I will be welcome at the House Karagin and to see both you and your brother again. If he is aware of the placement of my moles or freckles, then he has surprised me. Until last summer, I did not think he even was aware I existed. But That is a conversation for another day. My dearest, I hope there is good news on the topic of your heart when we meet next in Petersburg, and that it is less than 2 weeks until I see you.
Yeah, okay. That was good.
Well,
congratulations. We finished one cycle. It only took us two sessions. We'll pick up in 2 weeks' time with the next novel chapter. Maybe around 1807, peace of Tilsit, we could all be celebrating. The emperor could be giving a big ball.
Ooh.
His sovereign majesty, his wife and his mistress and the dowager empress will all be there. He had a great family life. And we'll see where they go from there and how close we'll get to Napoleon coming back. Because, yeah, that's the thing. Anyway, this was absolutely lovely. I cannot say how much I enjoyed this. I don't have enough words.
That's
great. You all are very lovely and terrifying monsters, and I adore you all. I just voted for a centrist candidate today, so I think rules are great. I've never done one of these. I'm very excited, full of energy, bursting with no ideas, but lots of energy.
That I do not have lies, but I will not tell them everything. I do not tell lies, but I will not, but I will keep secrets. Good Lord, I don't know what I'm saying. There's a lot of crossed out lines in this letter.
We are trash fires.
That's a little dangerous ball in Russia.
Yeah, well, I mean, fortunately, they have not invented a camera, or else the most dangerous place in the world would be to be between Aleksandra and a camera.
I mean, it's just a wrecking ball. Like, it's just not.
Hey, especially for all the single ladies out there, I want to create a guy who will come into town and be extremely eligible. So please feel free to start thinking of things, flaws and virtues for handsome Pete, who's going to be coming to town. So.
Sounds good. Will he be wearing a shirt?
We'll see.
In which scene?
I mean, look, man, I deserve it. Richard, that is seriously the most Richard inner conflict you've ever done. That's it. That sums it all up. Like 30 others hours joy. Of this damn thing.
And others' joy versus his own joy.
Sweetie,
we are well past 30 hours.
Are we? Oh, yeah, yes. I guess we are.
I feel like I'm taking a positive reputation tag of feminine despair.
Well, wait till reputation for that.
I just feel like people should know. Sometimes I do things out of order. I apologize to Haley.
You can't do that because then you'll throw me off. Spend 30 seconds here to make me a man. And it didn't take the first time.
Oh my God.
That one doesn't make the blooper reel. I'm sorry. I have some pride. You may not have noticed, but I have a little.
That's so fair. But that I'm
also impressed that you're taking way less time than Frankenfurter, who needed 7 days.
Yeah, well, come on, man. He got distracted a lot.
You know, because we're all dealing with like the realities
Serafina,
of
war. My dearest darling.
Yes, what did I do?
This is the Napoleonic Wars. There's almost nobody who's not inside the wars at this point. Switzerland is in the wars at this point.
Is America?
Well, no, not America, but come on.
Not at this point, but they will be.
Sasha has standards, man. Come on. All I know is one thing for sure.
Richard cannot play him.
Sorry.
Not going to fall in love with him, so why not? Yeah.
Because we tried to make Richard play a straight guy once.
Remember when that happened?
I never even got to bring him on stage.
He was on stage. He was
for all of like 30 seconds, and then Serafina seduced the person he was there to sleep with.
It was a little longer than that, but not much longer.
I do have a habit.
He did not have
people, and by rug I mean boyfriend. I go, sorry, were you using that? Interesting. His little picture is just yanks my heart out.
So it's funny, I chose that picture because he radiated dastardly twink energy.
Dastardly twink energy.
But heartbroken dastardly twink energy.
Dastardly twink energy is pretty much that. That's like your cover band name for this whole thing. Okay. Also, we need to do monologues. Monologues. Hello. Hi. Hi. Nothing on my head.
That's a Freudian slip right there.
Seriously, man. As a resident bisexual. Oh man, I could play that, but then there's Miroslav.
Yeah, I don't know.
Hey, my name is Kat Raman. I have a complex relationship with the Catholic Church.
How are you being such a marshmallow? What's going to happen next?
I don't know, but the sweeter I get, the worse it's going to be. I just know it.
I can't take it. It's like we're writing our own disaster movie.
Yeah, slowly moving towards it.